Your mic. We can see your video, but your mic is unmuted. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Yeah. Are we good to go, sir? Shall we start the session?
Yeah, sure. You can start. Yeah. No problem.
Akshat, please.
Am I audible?
Yes, please go ahead.
A very respected sir, ma'am, and my colleagues and seniors. We will invoke the day and the event with a small clip of Vande Mataram. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering presents eSamvad, a career-oriented research, entrepreneurship, and motivational talk series on every Wednesday throughout the academic session. Experts as well as students and scholars from various domains will deliver talks to motivate the undergraduate, postgraduate, and research community in the core sectors, that is research organizations, academia, and industry. So here I duly invite the HOD of Electronics and Communication Engineering Department, Dr. Priyanka Kokil ma'am, to enlighten everyone with the concept and inspiration behind eSamvad talk series.
Thank you, Akshat.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, Dr. Surinder Pal, and good morning, my fellow colleagues and my dear students. First of all, I welcome you all for the session. In fact, the first session for this academic year. So before I go into that detail, let me just give a very brief about the institute. Our institute, Indian Institute of Information Technology, Design and Manufacturing, Kanchipuram, is an institute of national importance established in 2007 by the Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India, to pursue design and manufacturing oriented engineering education, research, and to promote the competitive advantage of Indian products in global markets. It was declared as an institute of national importance by the Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India, in July 2011, thus becoming the first IIT to be accorded this status. Here we have Department of Electronics, Computer Science, Mechanical, and School of Interdisciplinary Design and Innovation. And Department of ECE offers BTech, MTech, and PhD programs in ECE. And faculty and students here in the department are deeply involved in research in almost all possible research areas. In fact, the if I can name the research areas that we are mainly involved in, RF and communication, we are there in signal processing, we are in power electronics, as well as we are in VLSI domain. Now, let me just give a brief that why we have started this concept of lecture series. So, author Joshua J. Marin says that challenges are what make life interesting, and overcoming them is what makes life meaningful. So the idea is like, if one can successfully handle the challenges, life becomes easy and beautiful. If I present the stat, like every year 15 lakh engineers graduate from various fields, be it mechanical, electronics, electrical, or any other domain, whereas just 0.2% of them get transferred to industry. So by considering this current scenario, the Department of ECE has conceived the idea of lecture series on every Wednesday, some around 2 years ago. And since then, we have started this exercise almost on all Wednesdays, which I'm happy to share that this year we have renamed this as eSamvad, which is a career-oriented research, entrepreneurship, and motivational talk series, where we invite external experts, students, scholars from various domains to deliver talks to motivate our undergraduate, postgraduate, and research scholars. The speakers are from various core sectors, from academia, industry, and so on. The idea is basically to provide a platform or gateway to the scholars to people to understand what actually is going on the research front in industries or in various institutes. In fact, this particular platform provides the PhD scholars a good platform to present their ideas to fellow students, to a wider public, to gain expertise, practice, and confidence of presenting their research work. Whereas for BTech and MTech, this provides a wide range of problems which are currently in demand, and which are in which the research is going on currently. So this allows basically to help them to select the research problems or to interact with the seniors so that they can do some sort of collaboration for further project work. Now, by considering this pandemic time, so we thought that let this knowledge to go to the distance in this time of social distancing. So we have opened this series as a live session through YouTube. In fact, this is the first of such session which will be live. So we can say that this is actually beyond the classroom. It is the kind of learning which goes beyond the classroom. So I hope that today's keynote speaker, Dr. Surinder Pal's interaction will be extremely good, and all the students will get a lot of benefit, be it research and be it from industry point of view. And any sort of interaction will be surely help them to groom themselves for future. I once again welcome Dr. Surinder Pal, and thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the wonderful introduction. Now a brief introduction about the guest speaker of today's eSamvad inaugural event, Dr. Surinder Pal. Sir, a researcher and an academician of international repute, having more than 50 years of experience in the field of antennas, RF microwave, radars, space communication, and satellite navigation. He was a DRDO Dr. D.S. Kothari chair at DGECS office in Bangalore. Dr. Pal was the founder and program director of Indian Satellite Navigation Program. He was also a professor and senior advisor of satellite navigation in Israel. He is the former Vice Chancellor of DIIT Pune. He was a consultant to several international agencies and organizations like International Telecommunication Union and NTU Singapore, etc. on satellite communications. Dr. Pal is a fellow of several reputed organizations like IEEE USA, Indian National Academy of Engineers, National Academy of Sciences, etc. He was also a distinguished fellow and president of IETE Journal from 2012 to 2014. He has received several national and international awards, including Judith Resnick Award from IEEE and BITS Pilani Distinguished Alumni Award from Sri Kumar Mangalam Birla. On a side note, we will be having a separate Q&A session after the talk. In the meantime, please feel free to type out any questions you all have regarding the topic in the chat box. So here I welcome Dr. Surendra Sir to shed some light on today's topic, that is advances in microwave, latest trends and research opportunities. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Akshat. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So, good morning to everybody. And thanks to Dr. Priyanka Kokil for the welcome, and Akshat for the nice introduction. The topic is very vast, you know, and it becomes more relevant in today's arena when things are interdisciplinary. If I look back into my student days, persons did not want to touch the field, even a big bowl. The condition has not changed much. Now also the field of RF and microwave is not opted by many students. The fault lies with the academicians, because since I was a vice chancellor for 3 years, I had seen the academics from a close quarters, and I find the way in which we teach is difficult. Now let me come to RF, my wireless communication. Okay, and what are the opportunities, etc. There, I am starting with the introduction that, you know, in our Indian philosophy we say that there is only one Brahma. Okay, because we call only one Brahma is there, which is present everywhere. I don't know about Brahma, etc., because I am not a great philosopher, nor I am a great scholar in the Indian mythology. But I know.
Excuse me, sir. Sorry to interrupt, but your screen is not visible to us, sir. Could you please share your screen once again?
Are you able to see now?
No, sir. You have to come to the Google Meet.
Video.
The Google Chrome window. We are able to see your video, but the screen is not visible.
Okay.
So right side of the video button, there is a screen, a start or stop sharing your screen button. If you click on that, the entire screen window will come.
I did it, you know, because it's a particular, there is a one square in which then arrow, toggle screen.
Yes, yes.
That if I pressed it
on that, a window will pop up.
Yeah, it will pop up.
Yeah,
yes.
In that you can select the entire screen, the image of the screen that you see. If you just click on that, yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now
yes,
is it
yes.
Seen?
It's perfectly visible, sir. Thank you. You may want to put it in full screen mode also, sir. Yes.
Is it
perfect, sir? Perfect. Please go ahead, sir. Sorry for the interruption.
Okay. We academicians don't give much importance to RF, and also the way of which we teach is also different. You know, I find that if we teach RF in a proper way, then persons will become interested in this. Shall I go ahead?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
There was a disturbance in between.
Yeah. Let me request the other participants to please mute yourself and allow the speaker to continue the session. Thank you very much.
Now, as I said, in our Indian mythology, one Brahma. So similarly, if you find which is present everywhere, you find the same way, or God is present everywhere, which every religion presumes so. The RF is present everywhere, whether it is air or vacuum or I mean, you can do star, sun, everywhere RF is present. If you look into the galactic, then also RF is present. I'm going to tell you about how RF is present. Okay. And somewhere in 59, 60, there were two scientists were there. One was Pangias and Wilson. Okay. And they made a big hog horn. They wanted to find out, they were doing some simple experiment on the radio astronomy. And they rotated the hog horn in every direction. They find that some particular noise is coming, which was in the, they detected and they put into some sort of audio, and they were finding there was a whistling sound coming. So they thought that hog horn, you know, it is a big horn, and on the mouth of the horn, lot of droppings of the pigeons were there. So they got it cleaned, and then also whichever direction they change to the pond. And then it was discovered that this was the cosmic background radiation, which was coming from all directions. It was independent of direction. It was independent of angular moment. And it was considered to be the part of residuals of the Big Bang phenomena. Then, and in 1978, these two researchers got Nobel Prize for the same. And the noise which they measured, background noise, was 2.725 Kelvin, and plus minus 0.1. That's all. Then NASA wanted to do a study, and in 89 to 93, they launched one satellite called Cosmic Background Explorer, which had a horn. It was a sun synchronous orbit at 900 kilometers, and they confirmed that yes, there was a background radiation, which is available in the whole universe, and it was independent of the angular projections, also independent of the direction, and the same 2.725. Now it varies little bit from depending on the atmospheric condition, etc. And if you the RF engineer, you know it, that atmosphere attenuates, at the same time it contributes then towards the noise also. So it was a sun synchronous orbit, 900 kilometers altitude. And they found out. Now, what is the importance of RF and microwave? Importance of RF and microwave is too much. Now, if you want to do a physics, I'm quite sure most of you must have heard about the Large Hadron Collider and antimatter, Higgs boson, and which was named after the famous scientist, Professor Satyendranath Bose. Such things, and it's a total thing is called CERN. In that one also, the high energy particles are accelerated using electromagnetics and microwaves. And LINAC are there. So LINAC, generate the high energy particles using them. Now, when you go for many places, for imaging, medical purposes, etc., you have got LINAC. High energy particles are there in the using, and which are put into a beam form for cancer treatment, etc. So there are everywhere you use RF. Now, when you get up in the morning, your mobile, so you get up signal from your mobile, your clock is in the mobile, then you see your news through the mobile or the TV, etc. Since you are working from home, you have got a network, internet, which also works somewhere on the RF. It may, it's mostly it works on RF. Now it's worked on the optical fiber also. But if you see at the back end of the optical fiber or front end, whichever way you want to see it, again, RF is there. So RF is part and parcel of everything. You start from your kitchen with the microwave oven to your mobile, to your TV, to, you have got RF lock, if you have got a car with a remote controller, it has got RF everywhere. RF is there. So such an important topic, why we are missing in the country. We have got more than the population of India, we have got the RF utility equipments in the country. Mostly you got mobiles and they involve RF, then you got TVs, they involve RF. So everything is in RF. I am reminded of one joke which in our Aryabhatta days, when Professor Damle, late Professor Damle from TIFR, used to say that Everything is made by Tatas. I'm not doing an advertisement for Tatas, like cloths used to be made by Tatas, toothpaste by Tatas, oil by Tatas, cars by Tatas, trains by Tatas, sugar by Tatas, soap, etc. also used to come from Tatas. What was not coming from Tata was made by Bata. The shoes we were not getting, so it was made by Bata. The joke behind it is that everything is RF, and if you go beyond RF, then only digital domain comes, or the computing domain, computational domain comes, for which most of the students go. So why not go in the front end itself? And then you can really do much better work, and you can dominate on the digital domain also. I'm going to introduce you to Acharya Jagdish Chandra Bose, who was the first person who generated millimeter waves, and the James Clerk, who total RF depends on that one. And then I'm going to simply touch about some of the subjects which are will be of interest to you. See, electromagnetics and RF communication antennas, RF and antenna, omnipresent, and they are tightly connected with each other as far as today's world is concerned. Today we are in the world of information technology, communication, navigation and communication, and the new emerging areas are Internet of Things and artificial intelligence. When I'm talking about Internet of Things, means everything it comes in that one. It's not only the Internet of Things which is defined by some papers that you can open, operate your TV, or you can operate your fridge or house, etc. But Internet of Things encompasses almost everything. All these need communication either by line or space. Millimeter waves, terahertz, infrared, optical communication are becoming part of the large communication control and information paradigm. In the introduction, I talked about the Kobe satellite, the cosmic background. This is the microwave window which we talked about, about which I talked. This is a terrestrial microwave window. If you find it's some sort of trough type thing, if you go up to 1 gigahertz, it's the known thermal background noise, which can go up to 1100-1500 Kelvin, depending on in which way you look and what is the frequency you choose it. Then if you go from 1 gigahertz to 10 gigahertz, this is the background noise, which we usually get 2.76 Kelvin. That's the background noise which I talked about it. When you go into the higher frequency, there are radiation absorption bands are there, like S2O, oxygen, water, and like carbon, nitrogen, etc. There are higher bands. So these things are also there. Now, why I'm trying to show it, that mostly today's communication is confined to this limit only. And you see H and OH, these two are radiation lines. That's called hydrogen line, hydroxyl line. And if you are looking for a life in extraterrestrial life, or search for extraterrestrial, then we usually look into these radiation belts. If these are it's called hydroxyl or water hole, we get the radiation in these lines, then we find that yes, there could be a life there. Okay, and before Chandrayaan 1, from the moon, we were never getting these lines because they were not available in the vapor form and there was no radiation. But after Chandrayaan 1 only, it was found out that yes, water is there on the moon also. Now, these absorption bands are used for many scientific studies also. And of course, they are used for many other purposes. They provide a beautiful window for scientific studies. In between, they provide a beautiful window for communication purposes. When you go to optical limits or optical side, then the quantum limits comes, H nu by K becomes a more prominent factor than the noise. So, but why I'm talking to you is that it was proved by Maxwell, I'm going to come to it, that everything is electromagnetic waves. That is, whether it's optical waves or it's RF waves, they're all, everything is electromagnetic waves. And the spectra starts from a few hertz to terahertz and beyond. Okay. Optical domain also. So we go in that. So this is called the microwave terrestrial window. And it's very useful. See here, I've written terrestrial window. And if you go into the space, then these bands are no longer available. And only what you get is a flat 2.76 Kelvin cosmic background radiation. Today is the era of electrically small antennas. new smart sensors, high gain filled arrays, wide band and ultra wide band, reconfigurable smart adaptive antenna systems, frequency selective surfaces, meta materials, and embedded antennas. Now you tell me what is left. Okay, if you want to work in the field of antennas, antenna is a part of front end and new materials, changing radar cross section by neural networks, use of singularity expansion methods. Importance of mathematics and software is in this present era, it's much more than that. You are in an era where easy problems have been dealt and life is complex and difficult with a lot of resources at hand. See, although life is complex and difficult, but also you got resources at hand. When I was doing the research, we did not have a, you know, most of the institutes, including IITs, did not have network analyzer. Okay, I was the first person in ISRO to buy a network analyzer, SP network analyzer. None of the IITs, ISC, or even DRDO had network analyzer. So you see, we came from that era. Then we started. Today, network analyzer is available for few lakhs of rupees. Field Fox, which does network analysis, which does spectrum analysis, and some of the network analyzers can do in the time domain analysis also. So need of the hour is to think out of box. These are the early contributors of electromagnetics: Benjamin Franklin, Alexander Volta, Andre Ampere, Michael Faraday, J.C. Bose, James Clerk Maxwell, Marconi, Tesla, and many more. Sir Jagdish Chandra Bose or Acharya Jagdish Bose was from 1858 to November 1937. He was a polymath, physicist, biologist, biophysicist, botanist, and archaeologist. He was the first person, in my opinion, a first scientist after a, you can say, Edison, Thomas Alva Edison, that who was a multidisciplinary person. Okay. In early British India, he was also a science and science fiction writer. Pioneered the investigation of radio and microwave waves and millimeter waves, optical, plant science, and laid the foundation of experimental science in Indian subcontinent. And I presume I have been told that not only Indian subcontinent, but I think this part of the Asia. Invented crassograph, a device for measuring the growth of plants. On Moon, a crater is named in his honor. A 1.3 mm multi-beam receiver now in use at NRA, or 12-meter telescope, Arizona, U.S., incorporates his concept from his original paper of 1897. This is the millimeter wave apparatus of J.C. Bose Museum, Calcutta. And he generated the, RF in this one. And he had a horn. He was the first originator of the horn by spark plug experiment, received it, detected it. Now, see, this is line diagram, and he also had some sort of a polarizer, did experiments with that one. In 1895, Acharya J.C. Bose gave his first public demonstration of electromagnetic waves, using them to ring a bell remotely and to explode some gunpowder. He sent an electromagnetic wave across 75 feet, passing through the walls and body of the chairman, lieutenant governor of Bengal. Transmission of electromagnetic waves. He was the first person to show transmission of electromagnetic waves. And since we Indians are not in the habit of patenting or publishing, and maybe we were under the British era, so he did not do it. Otherwise, he should have got the Nobel Prize in place of Marconi. J.C. Bose invented the mercury coherer together with the telephone receiver used by Marconi to receive the radio signal in his first transatlantic radio communication over a distance of 2,000 miles from Paul Duth, UK to Newfoundland, St. John's in December 1901. Marconi was celebrated worldwide for this achievement, but the fact that the receiver was invented by Bose was totally conceived. In 1896, he met Marconi. 1899, Bose announced the development of iron mercury, iron coherer with telephone detector. It is believed that his work influenced the work done by Marconi, Popov. Popov was a Russian communication engineer and other researchers working on radio communication. He was first to use semiconductor junction to detect radio waves. Maybe if he would have patented, he could have got a Nobel Prize. And his work on millimeter wave at Royal Institute in London. He used waveguides, horn antennas, dielectric lenses, various polarizers and even semiconductors at 60 gigahertz. J.C. Bose holds the first patent worldwide to invent a solid-state diode detector to detect EM waves. J.C. Bose was a pioneer in the field of microwave devices. His contribution remains distinguished in the field and was acknowledged by, you know, Lord Kelvin, Lord Rayleigh, etc. Acharya J.C. Bose also did studies on plants, metals, fatigues, cell response. He wrote a science fiction and IEEE named him one of the fathers of radio science. They did not say he was the originator, but they say one of the fathers of radio science. Now we come to the next person, James Clerk Maxwell, 1831 to 1879. He was one scholar who never experimented anything based on others' experiment. By mathematics, he proved that light is electromagnetic waves. He also calculated the velocity, and today's total electromagnetic waves or electromagnetic domain theory depends on his equations. These are the various equations he made it, and none of them were in a usable form at that time. But he used Gauss's law, and then he has Faraday's law, Ampere's law, Ohm's law, etc. And he introduced the concept of displacement current, which made the total theory complete. Otherwise, without displacement current, it is difficult to explain the behavior of electromagnetics. Oliver Heaviside was the next person. He was a self-taught electrical engineer who consulted all his different equations, which I showed you, and made them in vector form, in usable form, which today's four equations are there, based on Gauss law, magnetism. And till 40s, these equations were named as a Heaviside Heaviside Maxwell's equation, but somewhere the Heaviside name was dropped and only became Maxwell's equations. So these are the various Maxwell's relations. Okay, and he related the temperature, entropy, pressure, and volume. Maxwell was a genius. He worked in many areas, which we know only for that one. But he did work on inter-energy, Helmholtz, free energy, Gibbs free energy, thermodynamics, square, mnemonic, etc. And he also worked in the statistical mechanics. There's a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, which is a probability distribution, which is used heavily. And in artificial intelligence work, it's being used nowadays. Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution in the physics of statistical physics or mechanics, Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution is playing a very important role, particularly the probability distribution. And it's named after James Clerk Maxwell, Ludwig Boltzmann. But there are so many other things I'm just avoiding. The Maxwell material also he developed, it's a viscoelastic material, having the properties both elasticity and viscosity. It is named as James Clerk Maxwell viscoelastic material, who proposed the model in 1867. It is also known as Maxwell fluid. He generalized Maxwell model, also known as Maxwell Wiechert model, and I'm just skipping it. In electromagnetics, he introduced the concept of displacement current. I think it's a big subject, one itself, and I think the teachers should teach in a much better way. Okay. Maxwell theoretically showed that electromagnetic waves are light waves and vice versa. He also calculated the velocity, which almost matched with the measured one, much after his death. Maxwell's all calculations were based on observations and empirical formulations, which were later on proved. Hertz was the first to show the generation of and propagation of electromagnetic waves in small place. This is a spark gap and there are two spheres, he put it. And he showed that if you have a spark from here, it gets received from this side. Now, recent advances in microwave, RF and wireless communication. It is not possible in the present era to look into the topic in isolation. The boundary lines in various domains have faded and the field is multidisciplinary. To deal the present challenge of R&D and knowledge expertise in the following things are essential. Since I was told by Dr. Rinki Chopra that it's for mostly for the students, so I want to tell the students, and now AICT also will allow under the any you know, national education policy. Also, I'll tell the management of the IIIT that you can allow the dual degrees and good knowledge of mathematics, computational techniques, material science and physics, software tools, EM simulations. EM simulation, analysis, synthesis tools, engineering drawings and package techniques are essential. I'll suggest that the good knowledge of mathematics and computational tools and engineering drawing and packaging techniques are more essential for RF engineers and researchers. In my opinion, RF engineers should have good knowledge of the associated domains. And well, I jokingly say he should be an engineer who should have knowledge of from DC to daylight. Because little bit of DC in few hertz to kilohertz, you know, we have got a communication underwater. And of course, daylight, you know it, anything you can do it. An RF engineer, I feel, should have either have an RF, we should have two types of RF engineers. An RF engineer who knows only the engineering aspects of it. An RF technologist who should know the physics, who should know how the theory work, etc. Because there is no point in the thrusting the Maxwell's equations, or it's my personal opinion, or how they are derived, what are their importance, etc., and how the softwares are built across the, I mean, through the throat of an engineer who has got more engineering skills. This should be done to the technologists, left to the technologists. They will do much better, and their knowledge and their theories and also softwares developed, simulation tools developed by the technologists can be used by the engineers. Good knowledge of electromagnetics, simulation, analytical synthesis, tools preferably developed by your own are need of an RF expert. Most of the software tools are simulation ones. I feel there is a great need and scope for synthesis tools. Advances taken place are miniaturization of devices, advanced dielectric and magnetic materials, advent both metamaterials and frequency selective surfaces. Mind it, they are not available, they are made, they are all artificial as of now. RF CMOS devices, which are going up to 8 to 10 gigahertz, use of gallium nitride devices, advent of new semiconductor materials with variable energy gaps, that's the biggest research topic. An RF circuit having its own antenna, front end, back end, and going to digital domain, and we can say the total thing is available on a chip. No, so we earlier we used to have, you know, circuit on chip, okay, or system on chip, that was only for digital things. But now the total thing comes on the chip. And if you don't believe it, open your mobile. Need is to look into the high switching speed digital circuits, new semiconductor materials with the capability to handle radiation and multipacking, etc. New low noise, maybe sometimes if it's possible for me to visit, then I'll give an lecture on multipacking, RF breakdown, etc. In the electromagnetic circuits. New low noise devices for front end. Low noise itself is a great topic for RF research and doing it. Overall phase noise will also play a larger role. So low phase noise, miniaturized RF sources are being developed. Wide band devices and circuits. Techniques, hardware, as well as software-based tools to handle non-linearities in devices to cover wideband frequencies. Advances taken place need to carry out R&Ds, ultra-wideband and narrowband circuits, devices in the same system and simultaneously. MEMS and MMICs going to terahertz bands, microwave photonics. Miniaturized low-phase noise frequencies sources are being developed. They may include atomic clocks on a chip. They are available commercially with a frequency stability better than 1 into 10 to the power minus 11. Now you say, why do you want all these things? You know, when you go beyond gigabits and you are going to terabytes or terabits in a switching speed, then you need a clock which is much better stability. And when you go into the navigation, you know, India is also entered into navigation era. There, if you want to measure the distances, etc., in submeters, the clock's stability has to be better than 10 to the power minus 11, minus 14, or we have need a hydrogen measure, etc. Internet of Things, 5G, 6G, and beyond communications need very good knowledge of microwaves, RF, antennas, and devices. Quantum communications, quantum computing also fall in the same domain. Cognitive radars, radios, and phased arrays, adaptive antenna arrays going to millimeter waves with fast switching to feed the 5G, 6G, and beyond. And you know, this why I'm saying that when you go to 5G and 6G, particularly in the millimeter wave region of India, we are not going in that region as of today. But you know, everywhere there will be a switching of the beams, and definitely those things will be much more useful if you got a good knowledge and you can develop antennas, and back end will be switching circuits, which are also in high frequency switching speeds. You take it, then you need RF, etc. Knowledge, good RF. Inter-satellite links, high-speed internet, swarm of drones for defense, survey, and entertainment. The Starlink of space, is one thing which is in this direction. And recently, you have seen many things about drones. You heard about drones. So a swarm of drones can do damage, you know, for defense purposes. At the same time, for survey, you can use for anything. And swarm to swarm, you need to have a link. Okay. So there also the high speed drone links are very essential. Multi-band scanning arrays. So, you know, if you go for swarm drones, your antennas have to be miniaturized. You have to be in high frequency. Your devices also have to be miniaturized, and your power consumption should be very low. Concept of matching of return loss, which in my arena time used to be have 20 dB, but may not any longer be needed. You see, artificial intelligence will do every process in digital domain. Okay. Use of microwaves and RF in business and medical applications, including terahertz imaging, is gaining, foot. And there is a good scope for doing research in this direction. Remote sensing, microwave remote sensing, India has done wonderfully well. That's another area where a lot of research can be done. Use of absorption band in microwave windows for space link. Now, see, RF and microwaves, higher frequency research opportunities in science. Microwave spectroscopy, use in particle physics, study of accelerating the particles and increased speed. I did talk about CERN or Large Hadron Collider, and there, this microwaves or electromagnetics, good knowledge of electromagnetics, it comes into picture. Radio astronomy, you can do millimeter wave radio astronomy, you can do the low frequency radio astronomy, you can do the higher frequency radio astronomy. And when in the beginning itself said RF is everywhere, so it's the radio astronomy which also becomes a part of the RF. And since India, this Earth is generating so much of pollution of electromagnetic, if you put a telescope over moon, then you get an interference, you know. So if you can put a radio astronomy telescope on the rear side of the moon, then you can really study a very good, you can do very good radio astronomy research, and you can find out about the universe. You can find out about the, you can do the search for extraterrestrial life, etc. Then climate and weather monitoring, it's done in day in, day out in India and everywhere. Then ionospheric studies, which started somewhere in the 40s. India was doing very well in that one. But when we started working on our navigation program, we wanted to do the ionospheric model, make it. And we were shocked to say that in spite of all those ionospheric studies, no single model was existing. No proper data was existing because persons were interested only in doing some research, and their domain was very limited. Later on, we developed our own model in ISRO, and today NAVIC is based on NAVIC, and Gagan's all calculations are based on that model. So ionospheric studies are very important. Still, they can be done. Solar physics also involves RF. Study of new materials, microwave heating of scientific and industrial applications. Is there, you know, many of you may not be knowing that the tiles and in places like Italy, it's the tiles and bricks are also big using microwave heating. R&D opportunities are infinite. I cannot predict all the things, but I know it's much easier to do research in the field of RF or electromagnetics, optical domain, quantum domain, millimeter waves, terahertz, then, and you can do a wonderful research. You get a PhD much faster than developing a simple software or developing a computational tool, which you, yes, in the present era, you can get a good job, you can get good money. But if you want to satisfy your urge for doing the research, RF is the only field. You can start from few kilohertz to you can go to the terahertz. Well, that's what I had to say. And what I want to say is that you have your teachers have told you curl divergence of a vector is zero. Not in case of communication, not in case of RF. There is a convergence and fusion of various technologies. You can see your video conferencing, broadband internet, GEO, MEO, LEO satellites, DBS, VAST, LAST, live time network, broadband satellites, adaptive arrays, cable TV, mobile, SBAS, IoT, GPS, okay, and optical fibers. Then this one is there. I did not touch it here. What are the modulus? But I would touch it. What are the modulus you can do it? You know, when you need to transmit data, you have to have a much more bandwidth, and that those bandwidths are available only in case of higher RF or in the optical domain. And what are the new modulation techniques you can do it? So when you want to go to the higher data rate modulation technique, a knowledge of RF is also essential. If you want to tackle the EMI, EMC related issues in VLSI, etc., knowledge of RF is essential. So RF is everywhere. And thank you very much. I wish good luck to all the RF researchers and engineers. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful talk. In fact, I would like to thank you for providing some insight and giving your suggestion about this mathematics and computational techniques and engineering drawing and package techniques for RF courses. In fact, in our department, we are going, like recently we have done the curriculum revision and we are planning to have a specialization finalization process. So probably this will definitely give us insight and a lot of help, like, you know, what are the possible courses which can be planned for the students. Thanks for the comment, sir. And I hope that the talk is very beneficial for all the students. I found it really nice, in fact, to see something from the history to till now. It really attracts a lot. Like, it gives really a very nice feel that how it started from which place to which place we are in now. Thank you so much, sir, for today's talk. So today's talk session is open for question and answer.
Thank you, Dr. Priyanka. I think once this pandemic, if we are able to survive the pandemic, maybe sometimes I'll visit it, because I find that you are an autonomous institute. I know about NEP quite a bit. I had discussed with Dr. Rangan, and I know about it. I had been in the academics for some time and tried to change the curriculum. You can change the curriculum, you can make it really relevant rather than going from the old curriculums, which even you must have studied in your college days. My college days was different, so I don't want to talk about those things. But I know what are the things going on. So the total curriculum should be changed. It should be reframed. And not only in your field of electronics, it should be changed in the associated field areas also. Thank you. Yeah.
Sure, sir. Sure. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Yeah. So now the platform is open for question and answer sessions. And definitely, sir, once the pandemic is over, we would love to have you in our campus so that you can see the facilities, what we are having, our labs. And in fact, now we have a strong base of the people who are working in RF. So I think it will be definitely a great...
I want a couple of folks. you know, cheaper Fox are available, so you should buy, and they are good. The network analyzers, spectrum analyzers, etc. Have let this Agilent gives, then that is what is the Rodin Swartz gives, then that Japanese company, I'm just forgetting it, that gives. So there are 3-4 companies which give it. You must have those things quite a bit, rather than going for the slotted waveguide and all those things, you know, slotted lines.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We have, in fact, in our lab, we have. So yeah, that's what, sir, I'm saying, that once this is this pandemic is over, definitely we will invite you and we'll hope to meet you soon.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there are a few questions in the chat box.
Sure, please. If you want to ask now, you can ask it.
Yes, yes, sir. There is a question that what's your take on 6G and how different and better will it be from the current technology?
Well, it's as of now, what's imagined for 6G is, I mean, it can do anything. You know, like when I say RF engineers should be from DC to daylight, 6G also promises. And the, I mean, for 6G, sky is the limit. But what are the other problems it will have it, you know, including the environmental problem, etc., and ecological problems, that nobody has looked into it. That's a topic of good research. But if 6G becomes operational, I mean, you know, persons, when we want to say something, it should be done now. As soon as I say, things will be done and now. The communication will take place, the data rates will be very high, and you know, that will boost the cloud computing. Everybody need not have a computer. Now, suppose you have got a computer, everybody has got a computer in the house. So cloud computing, which is becoming popular, with 6G, it will spread like anything. And I'm finding that 6G will be much better. See, now itself with the 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G, itself we are finding quite a bit, you know, high-speed data network, etc. 5G is becoming popular, and but persons are using more, I mean, general public uses more for the video display, or you say TV, etc. Very few persons use, but it's being used for office purposes, etc. also. And I think it will boost cloud computing more than data analysis, etc. In much better way. Connectivity will be fastest. Before you ask, the connectivity will be there. That sort of thing there.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, when this 6G will be projected, like during what era? Like, since 5G is also not yet fully into India, when do you expect 6G into the market?
Let me tell you, there are two things are there, you know. Technological development is one thing, and commercial aspects and lobbying is another thing, okay? So, if something becomes popular in the commercial domain or for usability, depends on the latter half, once it's developed. You know, like WiMAX, in my opinion, was a very good tool. But because of the lobbying and the commercial aspects, it did not work very well. So, if commercial aspects are quite good, and other, you know, lobbying, political clearances, etc., if are there, then 5G may become popular in another 2 years, and 6G may be another 4 to 5 years. That's what my thinking is. But provided other things which I mentioned, which are non-technical. Thank you.
Sir, there is one more question in the chat box, that there is a lot of research going on in biological effects of RF and microwaves. Do we have some scientific evidence on any harmful effects as of now?
You see, I think 2 years back, this 5G was tried in Amsterdam. and 150 birds died in the park. Okay. Now, it's also believed that the population of house sparrows, you know, which we must have seen some 20 years back. I mean, actually, Bangalore, I have not seen at all except at the airport. They are dwindling population of the vultures, dwindling population of bees. Some researchers have found that it has got an impact on the yield of oranges, you know, this your mobile communication radiation, etc. So, nobody has conclusively shown that this is there, but yes, some researchers have found out, and Dr. Girish Kumar of IIT Bombay is a good friend of mine. He has published some papers, and also he is trying to make everybody aware that there can be adverse effects, or there are adverse effects of RF absorptions. Now, there are two, three things are there, you know, hardcore RF engineer to start with. Now, of course, I'm also a digital communication and navigation person. Many persons ask me whether microwave heating is good or not. Microwave heating in the microwave ovens, you know, it's a dielectric heating by dipole, you know, moment, and it vibrates, you know. And if you have got a hydroxyl ion in that one, it vibrates much faster and the dielectric heating much better. Whether it changes characteristics or not, it's a non-nucleonic or non-ionized radiation. So, whether it affects or not, but some persons say it affects. We have seen this thing, that thing. But these are all for hearsay. There is no conclusive proof or not much study. Somebody has published it, although a lot of persons are trying to say it. But I heard these things, I read about these things also, that there are adverse effects of RF radiations on biological objects, including the human being. One thing which I saw it when, we were working on X-band for our IRS data task. So, at X-band, any leakage used to affect the eyeballs, in the sense there will be a irritation in the eyes. And also, American Navy published once, you know, that radiation leakage from radars, you know, particularly radars working in the X band or that band near the military bands, you know, used to affect the reproduction rate. So, to conclude, it does affect, but we have to take precautions of all these things. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question. How can we use RF in neurobiology?
Well, I'm not an expert on neurobiology, so I can't say it. But definitely, if you can, if you are looking for a small point, then you have to go to the higher frequencies, have dielectric lenses and lens thing, and you can pinpoint at one point. So I'm not an expert, but they use definitely an RF heating for, internally heating and killing or destroying the tumors, you know, cancerous tumors inside the body. Something has been done in that direction. So I don't know what is neurobiology. So I really can't say. I don't want to go just by simply, translating the name and trying to find out, because I'm not an expert in that direction. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Is there any more questions from the audience?
Some students have raised their hands, so we can allow them to.
Yes, please. Yes.
Chaitanya, you have raised your hand. So.
Okay. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good morning, sir. I wanted to know a bit more about how you're using RF in radio astronomy, right? You just briefed over it. Just if you could tell a bit more about it.
Yeah. Well, can you repeat it? Because I could not make out what you are looking for.
Yes, I said, can you just explain once again how you're using RF in the radio astronomy?
Oh, radio astronomy.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You see, every material has got transmits some radiations, you know, it has got its own radiations. Either it absorbs or it transmits. Okay. And the radiation, it comes in its own body, its own internal mechanism, you know, because of the dipole moments or by the molecular or atomic moment, etc., it radiates something. Second is, these radiations also get modified by when you impinge radiations of that one. It could be microwave radiations, it could be IR radiations, it could be optical radiations, and then you do the spectroscopy, etc. So, based on the same principle, you know, the galactic sources, okay, or the stars, etc., they also transmit in various frequencies. And with large antennas, sensitive receivers, we get those signals, okay, and then try to analyze them, do the signal processing, and find out where the peak is there, what sort of material is there, because we know each material which is known to us, what are their radiation characteristics, you know, like I showed you S line, OS lines, and those frequencies. From there, we can make out. Not only this, we can find out their polarization characteristics also. And from there, we can find out. So, that also can give us a knowledge about the how the universe was formed. Like I give you an example of Kobe, it's a residual of the Big Bang phenomena, etc. Now, mostly this radio astronomy is done from starting from a say higher VHF to millimeter waves, etc. It's done. And India is quite pioneer in the direction. Raman Research Laboratory in Bangalore does it for millimeter waves. Giant meter wave radial telescope, there are big 45 meter diameter antennas, 15 antennas are there. 15 or I think 15 antennas are there near Narayangaon in near Pune. They do up to L band. In Ooty, there is a radio telescope, 326 megahertz. A large cylindrical telescope is there that's doing. There is a square kilometer radio astronomy array is coming up for paraboloids in South Africa. So, a lot of work is going on in radio astronomy, because radio astronomy is done only in these frequencies, millimeter waves, VHF, and in between frequencies, particularly. And they try to do the research where there are no radiations. You know, like Narayangaon radio telescope gets interfered by mobile communications because everybody does not control the radiations. Similarly, low frequency gets polluted by the unwanted radiations from the TV towers, etc. But in between, really, there are bands which are reserved by the ITU for radio astronomy research. So, large telescopes are made for those purposes. And there is a good amount of research is going on across the world. The major radio astronomical research centers are in US, India, and Australia. And now, South Africa is coming up.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question from Professor Raghavan. He's asking, how to make microwave engineering subject popular among students?
To Professor Raghavan, I cannot reply.
Okay, sir.
We have discussed so many times. He's a good friend. We have discussed n number of times. And we always agree. But yeah. To make it popular, I think that it's the academicians only who have to do it. First thing, you know, if Professor Raghavan recollects, once I think he was also present when I was arguing with the late Professor Tapan Sarkar, that why this, you know, my concept of technologists and engineers. Engineers should be given the fundament, not much of mathematics, only the tools they should be taught. Technologists should be given the mathematics. Why the, you know, difficult Maxwell's equation, the derivation should be put down the throat of an RF engineer. And because he should be told about the concepts, physics, etc. And if that is done, then it will become popular. But yes, if somebody wants to do research, he wants to develop the tools, he wants to go do the advancements, then he also should know the mathematics and other things. Otherwise, so many software tools are available. And if the persons become expert in those tools, then definitely the present generation will do much better than in RF than what we have done it. And I still feel that's why I told Dr. Priyanka that, and maybe if God willing, if we meet, then we can, you can invite Professor Raghavan also. We can design the course in that way. And two types of engineers. I mean, you know, one is engineer. Engineer means who develops the hardware and delivers the thing. Another, technologist. So we have to slightly differentiate between the two. Who should be taught more theory and who should be told about the applications and taught applications. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I request Professor Raghavan to please unmute and interact? I'm sure the interaction will be very useful for us. Professor Raghavan, may I request you to please unmute?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, you're audible. Welcome, sir.
Really, you brought the first person who can talk on this talk during the inaugural talk. So I cancelled my class and came to hear Dr. Paul. How many number of times he tells that much beneficial it will be for students. Especially, I request Madam Rinki Chopra to again invite him to talk on polarization. Polarization is a difficult topic for students, but he will make them feel as a child's play. And for the information of the great Vice Chancellor Dr. Paul, I want to tell Dr. Rinki Paul herself, a lost scholar of your friend Dr. Girish Kumar. Really, I enjoyed your lecture. Even if I hear 100 times, I will keep hearing your lecture because that cannot be found in the books.
Thank you, Professor Raghavan.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, there is one more question in the chat box. In spectroscopy, now researchers are trying to use RF absorption for food quality check. Will it affect food under test?
Well, whatever I understand, it should not affect. But some persons feel that, like, you know, I said microwave heating itself, they quote some Japanese research. I could never find out who has done that research, that it affects the food quality. So as of now, it's not we are not sure whether it affects or not. Because I feel that's a microwave, it's a dielectric heating. I said that, and mostly it gets heated because of the OH ion. You know, it's if you go into a little bit of physics, and you see, like you put a Teflon in microwave oven, it does not get heated because it does not have OH ion. Okay. If you put butter, it melts in no time because it's a, if you go into the physics of that one, that it's a fatty acid with a lot of OH ion. Okay. So it depends on what is the water content, what is the, how much is the OH ion in that one. So because of the dipole moment or dipole vibrations of the atomic dipole vibrations or molecular dipole vibrations, whichever is applicable there, the heating takes place. So once the heating is over, nobody has come out with that any orientation or thing has changed. When we eat the things on the prima facie, nothing changes except heating, etc. So I'm not sure about it, but there are a lot of persons feel it should not be done. I mean, a lot of persons feel means only in WhatsApp. I have not seen any article. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, please.
There's Ravish raising his hand, so we can ask him.
Yes, Ravish, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, my question is, what could be a well-defined path to become a radio astronomy expert?
You see, three things you should know. One is RF, that is communication, etc. About the antennas, receivers, low noise, etc. It's not very difficult. Second thing, you should be very good in mathematics and signal processing, digital signal processing and interpretation of data. Then you can be a wonderful radio astronomer.
Thank you, sir, for the information.
Any other questions from the audience, please? If not, then I would like to say thank you so much again, for your time, sir. It was really very nice interaction with you. And I hope to see you in person soon in our campus. And of course, with Professor Raghavan as well. Now I will request Dr. Srijit to please deliver a vote of thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, one and all. It's a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. First and foremost, let me express my sincere gratitude to our chief guest, Dr. Surendra Pal, who despite his busy schedule has found time to grace this event with his presence and words of wisdom. Sir, we thank you for accepting our invitation and inspiring all of us with your wonderful talk. We are really honored to have experienced this session from a stalwart in RF. I'm sure our students have also been motivated to explore the vast ocean of RF and wireless technologies. On behalf of the IIITDM Kanchipuram community, I extend our gratitude to you, sir. Our beloved director, Professor DVLN Somaiah Julu, has always been a source of inspiration for all of us. Sir, we are thankful to you for remaining our anchor of support and especially for encouraging our proposal to initiate this talk series. Let me also take this opportunity to thank Professor S. Raghavan, yet another giant in microwaves, for gracing the session with his presence and interacting with the audience. On behalf of the organizing committee, may I take this opportunity, sir, to request you to deliver a talk on this platform in future. I express my sincere thanks to Dr. Priyanka Kokil, HOD ECE, for her continuous support and constructive suggestions in revamping this event. In fact, the idea of starting such a talk series in 2019 was her brainchild. Ma'am, we hope to receive your support in all future events as well. I would also like to take this opportunity to express my sincere gratitude to my fellow faculty coordinators, Dr. Rinki and Dr. Rohini, for their wholehearted support and meticulous efforts in organizing the talk series from this academic year. Success of today's inaugural session is the culmination of the tireless efforts of our vibrant and energetic student team consisting of Akshat, Atharva, Chaitanya and Ravish. Thank you guys for putting up a great show. Let me also express my gratitude to my colleagues and technical staff in the EC department for their encouragement and support. I also thank the Institute administration for their support. Let me thank all the faculty and staff who have accepted our invitation and attended this inaugural talk. Last but not the least, let me thank our dear scholars and students who took part in this event. We hope to see much more participation in the future talks as well. Once again, I thank one and all present here. Thank you very much.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
With a due apology to the organizers, I want to tell one thing. I came with a lot of eagerness to hear Dr. Paul's lecture, but I found some accidental coincidence. Dr. Srijit was my proud M.Tech student. And the M.Tech level itself, he published 2-3 journal papers for having done practical work in the NPOL. And secondly, now only I come to know the director also. The director, Dr. Somaiah Julu, was my research scholar. He was my same year we were doing in the IIT Delhi. So these two things I came to know accidentally, thanks to a real practical giant. Dr. Paul, many may not know, He was instrumental in many of the satellites, antenna in our country, many, many things, including Gagan. So really, I am very, very happy to meet so many things and come to know many accidental good things, like Srijit, the doctor, your director, everything. Thanks a lot. Sorry that I interfered after the vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good luck to everybody.
Thank you so much, sir.
Hello. Atharva, are you there?
Yes, please go ahead.
Atharva? Okay, so we will be heading towards the end of today's inaugural event with the national anthem. So yeah, I'll be sharing my screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes. It's not audible, but I guess.
Hello, is it not audible?
Yes.
Now it's fine.
Just a second, sir. I'll reshare.
Your screen is already shared.
No, I'll reshare audio. Just a second.
I think still audio is not there, or is it audible?
Audible, ma'am.
Thank you.